We have approximately 2 hours today now to for whatever we want to do with the magnificent journey. But inshallah, I try to limit it to an hour and a half. It'll be just a general coverage of the book, which I'm sure that the time available is not sufficient for it, but that's what we can do, the best that we can do. And in the remaining time, I'm hoping that we will have chance to discuss something else which is very important for the half hour that will be left before Maghrib, inshallah. The book The Magnificent Journey has been published in Arabic by different titles, some of them, one of them being Ar-Risala at-Tabukiyya, the Risala of Tabuk, or from Tabuk. And one of them is, and that is historically because of the place where Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah wrote that letter in answer to somebody who asked him a question. So it is basically a long letter, and sometimes it has the title Al-Hijratu Allahi wa Rasulih, Migration to Allah and His Messenger. And sometimes it is published as Tuhfatul Ahbab, as in this edition that is in my hand, which means gift to the lovers. That last title being taken from the last chapter, or the last few words in the letter or in the booklet, saying that this is a gift to the beloved or the lovers, those who love each other and for Allah's sake. Risalat al-Tabukiyya, written by Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, who is the most famous of the students of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, is a letter which covers things that deal almost with everything that a Muslim is concerned with. It deals with the Aqidah, with the Manhaj, with the Quran, and with the deeds of the heart, with the raqa'iq and akhlaq. So it is amazing indeed that such a small booklet or such a small letter covers such a vast amount of material, even though in a concise way. Inshallah, what I'll try to do is cover, because of the limitation of time, cover some of the important points that I learned from or observed to be important in this book, or in this booklet or letter. It starts by mentioning the ayah from the Quran. So Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah starts off by mentioning the ayah in which Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. So, and he will link the end of the letter with the risala with the beginning. So as you see, he will come back, even though after a while you'll forget that this is what he started with, but he will come back at the end to the same thing and remind you that the whole letter or risala was nothing but some advices on as to how to mutually help each other in birr and taqwa. So it is an advice to the Muslims in general, and specific to those to whom he wrote this letter, telling them to mutually help each other on birr and taqwa. So he brings the ayah, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ, which means help each other to birr and taqwa, and do not help each other to evil, to ithm, sinning, and udwan, which means transgression. And he will be explaining linguistically more clearly what these words mean. And revere Allah, have taqwa of Allah. Indeed, Allah is severe in His punishment. And he indicates that this ayah encompasses all what's good for people, all that is of benefit for people in this life and in the hereafter, whether it is in their mutual dealing with each other or in their dealing with their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this is all what is of importance, of course. We are, in whatever we do, we are either dealing with each other or doing something between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore this ayah covers everything. Why is that? Because it's telling the Muslims or people to help each other, to deal with each other, so that they will be doing more of birr and taqwa and less of evil, of sinning and transgression. And then he says, wattaqullah, have taqwa of Allah. So that is, first part is between people, and the second part is wattaqullah, have taqwa of Allah. Allah is great in his punishment. Then he explains what is the meaning of taqwa, and indicates that taqwa is actually part, the meaning of taqwa is part of the meaning of birr, and vice versa. Birr, the meaning of birr is part of the meaning of taqwa. Taqwa, we usually translate it to be piety or fear, God fearing or something like that. So taqwa in Arabic and birr, which we usually translate as righteousness, are common in meaning. They have a lot of common meaning between each other. And when we usually say taqwa, we mean birr. And when we say birr, we mean taqwa, as he will explain. Except when they come together, then that means that there is a slight difference in the meaning of the two. So as in this ayah, they are mentioned, both of them are mentioned, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Help each other in birr and taqwa. So that means when they come together, they cannot be redundant. That means that they have distinctive meanings. And this is, he brings examples of this in Arabic, in Islam, in the Quran and Sunnah, where when one word is used, it means the other, or when the other word is used, it means the first. But when they come together, they have different meanings. As an example, he brings Iman and Islam. When we talk about Iman, we mean Islam. And when we talk about Islam, we mean Iman. So when we say a person is mu'min or believer, or all you who believe, we mean that Allah is addressing the Muslims. And when we say a person is a Muslim, it means he is a believer. Salaam wa rahmatullah. Or it's expected that he is a believer at heart. Now, when they come together in one text, then there must be a difference in meaning between the two. So when we say, when we read the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam, in which he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam about Islam and about Iman and about other things, then and the answers were different. They came in the same text, so here they have separate meanings. That in that case, Islam means the apparent actions of Islam, and Iman means the hidden action of Islam in the heart, the belief, the actual belief. But as I said, when either of the two words comes by itself, it encompasses, normally refers to the whole thing. Similarly, in the Quran, where Allah Azza wa Jal says, "قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قلوا أسلمنا," the Bedouins said, "We believe." Say, you do not believe, but say, "We are Muslims." They said, "We are believers now." He tells them, "Do not say we are believers. You are Muslims." وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ, and Iman has not entered your hearts yet. So here there's distinction. Iman, Islam is referring in this ayah to the outward actions of Islam. And that's what the Arabs started doing, practicing, and so that by that they are believers at heart. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling them, no, you are not at that stage yet. Say that you are Muslims. So you should be treated as Muslims. Your actions are the actions of Muslims. And there are other examples, he says, in this, similar to these in the Sharia in Islam. Like when we say Iman and when we say Al-Amal Al-Salih. Aman Amana wa Amila Salihan. The one who does good deeds, that means he's a believer. Or the one who is a believer, that means he does good deeds. But when they come together in one context, in one text, then they have separate meaning. Each one has a different meaning. Like وَأَمَّا مَنْ آمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. As for him who believed and did good deeds, then they have different meanings here. And here Iman is referring to the basic Iman, to the basis of Iman, which is believing in Allah and His Messenger, and the rest of the items of Iman. And good deeds is anything which builds on it. Similarly for the words faqir and miskeen, when you say faqir you mean miskeen, when you say miskeen you mean faqir. But when they come together, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, innama sadaqatu lil fuqara'i wal masakin wal 'amilin 'alayha, etc., then here there is distinction between them and meaning. They do not say mean the same thing. Similarly fusuq wal asyan, which came in this ayah. No, this ayah said had ithm and udwan, but also fusuq wal asyan is similar. Fusuq is sinning and asyan is sinning or rebellion or disobedience. So when they come together in one sentence or in one text, they mean different meanings, whereas if you use any one by itself, it includes the other in meaning. Similarly for munkar and fahisha and many other examples. And since I mentioned this example about faqir and miskeen, I should point out, because there is a misconception about the use or the meaning of the hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allahumma ahyini miskina wa amitni miskina wa hshurni fi zumrat al-masakin. Many people, even though this mentions miskeen, and we said that miskeen, when it comes by itself, it includes the meaning of faqir or poor man, but this does not apply to this hadith because of the context of the hadith, because we know the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of what the scholars have explained this hadith with. It is here miskeen, it means humble, and sakina or maskana is part of the meaning of miskeen. Submission, to be submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not a poor man compared to to the other people who were living in his time. He was not classified as among the poor people, the needy people. He was an average man. He was living a sufficient life so that he does not need to go to people, as he made in the dua. He is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make his rizq kafaf, which means to make his sustenance such that it is sufficient for him. He doesn't have to turn to people for help. So he was not a faqir, but he made the dua to be miskeen, and he was a miskeen indeed, in the sense that he was submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was humble, he was not arrogant. So in that dua he is asking Allah to make him live as a humble man and die as a humble man and be resurrected with the humble people and not with the jababira, with the tyrants. Okay. So after bringing these examples, Imam Ibn Qayyim says that this is a very important rule that he should realize, like he brings about other things about the knowledge of Shara, of Quran and Sunnah. An important rule that those who understand it, that will remove many misconceptions from their head. Because some people mix between the meaning of one word and the meaning of another word, and therefore make wrong derivations based on that. So he says, you have to understand this to remove many of such things, such misconceptions. So here we have the word al-birr wa taqwa, help each other in birr and taqwa. Al-birr, then he starts discussing the word birr and how it means in all its various derivations and forms, whether it is birr or burr, and the thing that derived from it, it's referring to something which is honored or high in class or position compared to other things of the same kind. So al-birr is a word which encompasses all kinds of goodness, all sorts of goodness and perfection which is acquired from the human being. And this is the opposite thing to this is ithm, sinning. So anything opposite to birr is ithm, and anything opposite to ithm is birr. And then he brings the hadith of Nuwas bin Sam'an when he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about birr and ithm, and he told him سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن البر والإثم فقال البر حسن الخلق والإثم ما حاك في صدرك وكرهت أن يطلع عليه الناس, which means بر is good manners, good character, and إثم, sinning, is that which builds in your heart, in your chest, and you hate for people to see it. So it could be something in the heart. Sinning is something which starts from the heart. And then there is the other hadith. Actually, there is a comment here which is not in the translation. I neglected it from there, which is that Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he brings part of the hadith, the hadith of Wabisa, and he says that Nuwas bin Sam'an, that this was said to him by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But actually, this was said to Wabisa. So I just put in the translation both of the ahadith, because they both are connected in meaning or related meaning to the discussion. But Ibn Qayyim only brought the first part of the hadith of Wabisa, in which he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about al-birr and ithm. So he did not answer him, and after that he called him to him and he said, come closer. And then he said, you are asking about birr and ithm, and then he gave him the answer, which I believe I've included it in the translation. So I included both of the full ahadith, even though in the original text there is only the first part of one of the two ahadith. So al-ithm is a word, as Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah says, is a word which encompasses all sorts of evil and deficiencies for which a abid, a servant, is blameworthy. Anything that a person is blameworthy for is ithm, and anything for which a person is praiseworthy, it is birr. So that's the difference between birr and ithm. So he says by that, under birr comes the meaning of iman. Comes iman. Iman is a kind of birr, or part of birr. Whether it is the apparent types of iman or the hidden part. And definitely taqwa is part of this. Taqwa is part of iman. Because taqwa is, as he will be explaining a little bit after that, it is to refrain from doing things that displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of fear of Allah, and to do what Allah commands out of love and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by that, taqwa is related, strongly related to iman, especially. It mixes actually the hidden and apparent actions of iman, and therefore it comes under birr in meaning. And come on. So therefore the conclusion is that birr derives from taqwa, and you can say vice versa, as we said before. Because taqwa is fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in open and in secret. So by that, it means that everything we do is consistent with the righteousness, with the acts of righteousness, with the acts, praiseworthy acts, which is birr. So therefore, taqwa is birr and birr is taqwa. But as we said, when they come together, birr applies to the actions of birr, to the apparent actions of birr, and taqwa to the thing which addresses more what's in the heart. And then he brings the ayah which says, لَيْسَ الْبَرَّ أَنْ تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. It's a long ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah, in which Allah Azza wa Jalla says what means it is not righteousness or birr to turn your faces to the right, to the east or west, but birr is to do such and such and such and such. He mentions many actions, righteous actions, including belief. So he starts by actions of belief of the heart. من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين. And then actual actions of the limbs, of the body. وآت المال, gives the wealth in spite of loving it, to the ذوي القربى, to the relatives, to the orphans, to the masakin, to ibn السبيل, the wayfarers, to the beggars, people who ask for it. وفي الرقاب, to free the slaves. And also أقام الصلاة وآت الزكاة, that who established the prayers and gives the zakah. And then, as you see, he first mentions actions of iman, the pillars of iman, believing in Allah and the last day and the angels and the prophets. These are the pillars of iman. And then he added to that actions including the pillars of Islam, like giving, establishing the prayer, giving the zakah, and so on. So these are actions of the body, as I said, of the limbs, including the pillars of Islam, as we call them now. And then he added to that actions of the heart. Actions of the heart. He said, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَهَدُوا, those who fulfill their promises when they give a promise or a covenant. So that is a combination of the heart. They have this truthfulness in their hearts to fulfill their promises. They fulfill their promises, and who have sabr. And this is again a combination of, they have the strong heart to be patient and steadfast in situations of hardship and opposition, when people are harm them and so on. في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس, at the time when they are standing in the fighting in the battle. And then he says, after that, Allah Azza wa Jalla makes the conclusion after listing all the characters or examples of characters that pertain to birr, to righteousness. He then concludes by saying, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا, those are the truthful ones, which means those who do such things are the truthful ones. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ, and those are the ones who have taqwa. So he concluded that whoever has the characters, the characteristics of birr, is a person who has the characteristics of taqwa. So he starts by birr and he ends by taqwa. So you see that how the meanings of birr and taqwa are intertwined and very strongly related. He mentions, where is it? Okay. Here he mentions a saying by Talq bin Habib that I just mentioned part of it briefly. And you will notice in the statements of Ibn al-Qayyim and in the statements of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahumullah, you'll find statements which they take from people of the Salaf who were attributed to Sufis, to Sufism, to Sufiya. They take statements from them, from those who were just attributed to Sufiya, even though it is not demonstrated that they were Sufis. But the Sufis like to claim that they are on their side. Like the Shia, for example, say that Ja'far as-Sadiq rahimahullah, he was their leader, but he was one of the imams of the Sunnah. Similarly, the Sufis say Abu Qadir al-Jilani, for example, he was a leader of Sufism, and he was by the standards of the Sunnah, he was a deviant person, but he was not. He was of the people of Sunnah. And similarly, you find several other examples from other people, famous people among the Sufis, who first they are actually people of Ahl Sunnah and sometimes of the scholars of the Sunnah, and the statements, some of them are false statements that are not true about them, and other statements the Sufis interpret them in a bad way, but actually they have a good and very useful interpretation. So you will find some of this in the sayings of Ibn Taymiyyah Ibn al-Qayyim, and unless a person has the knowledge to understand this and to be able to discern the difference between the explanations of Ahl Sunnah and Ahl Bid'ah, then he should be careful in reading such statements, especially if they come without the explanation of the scholars of the Sunnah. So he says this statement from Talq ibn Habib. He says, إِذَا وَقَعَتِ الْفِتْنَةُ فَأَطْفِئُهَا بِالتَّقْوَى. When the fitna occurs, then extinguish it with taqwa. They asked him, what is taqwa? He said, التَّقْوَى أَن تَعْمَلَ بِطَاعَةِ اللَّهِ عَلَى نُورٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ تَرْجُو ثَوَابَ اللَّهِ. It is, taqwa is to act by obedience, which means to do acts of obedience to Allah, عَلَى نُورٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ, upon a light from Allah. What does it mean upon light from Allah? It means with guidance from Allah, because Allah sent His guidance in His book. He called His books Nur, light. So any Nur from any guidance from Allah is a Nur from Allah, because it lights our darkness, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Allah waliyyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. Allah is the wali, the close friend and the defendant of the believers. He brings them out from dhulumat, from darkness, ila nur, to light. So Allah gives light to the believers with His guidance. So you do acts of obedience to Allah, ala nur min Allah, based on the light, on guidance from Allah, based on the teachings of Allah in His book and the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tarju thawab Allah, and by that you are seeking the reward from Allah. That's taqwa. And the other half of taqwa is wa an tatruka ma'siyat Allah, to stay away from disobeying Allah, ala nur min Allah, same thing, with guidance from Allah, why? Fearing the punishment of Allah's punishment. Okay, so this is the definition of taqwa. And he says, Ibn Qayyim comments, he says, this is among the best definitions that were ever said for taqwa, or the explanations of taqwa. And it indeed is. I mean, you can see what the scholars have said about taqwa, and this is among the most encompassing definitions of the meaning of taqwa. And then he, in his discussion to prove that this is the case, this is probably important, so we should go over it. Why is it among the best things said regarding taqwa? He says, because every action has a beginning and end, which means it has an initial, a starting point, and it has a goal. Whatever we do, it starts somewhere, and we have a goal by doing it. Sometimes many of us do not have goals, they just live haphazardly, but normally an action has a beginning and a goal, and sometimes even if we do not have a goal, there is a goal for the thing. Even if we are going without a purpose and aim in life, there is a goal, there is an end that we will reach one day, whether it's something that we like or not. So the action, any action will not be ta'ah, will not be an act of obedience, unless it initiates from iman, from belief. So the initial point, the starting point, should be iman. فَيَكُونُ الْبَعِثُ عَلَيْهُ الْإِيمَانُ الْمَحَدُ, which means the thing that initiates it or pushes a person to do it is pure iman, and it is not the habit or desire or seeking position or praise from people or other reasons. It must start from iman. And the goal for any action of obedience is seeking the thawab of Allah, the rewards from Allah and His pleasure. And this is what ihtisab is. That's why I brought this, because you hear frequently the word, especially in Ramadan, man sama Ramadan imana wa ihtisaba, the one who fasts Ramadan with iman and ihtisab. So he says this is the meaning of ihtisab. It is seeking the thawab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, expecting the thawab from Him. And he says that is why these two things are frequently combined together in the text of Islam. Man sama Ramadan imanan, with iman and ihtisab, which means the starting point is correct, which is iman, and the goal is correct, which is seeking the reward of Allah. That's ihtisab. So this is iman and ihtisab. Same thing, man qama laylat al-qadri imanan wa ihtisaban wufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi, and nadhairu, and there are similar things in the text of Islam that you can find. So he goes back to this statement of Talq bin Habib. He says, "Ala nurin min Allah is indicating or referring to the first, the starting point, which is upon a guidance or light from Allah. It is to it is referring to the belief, which is the initial or starting point of the action, and seeking tarju thawab Allah is referring to the second as part of it, which is the goal of any deed." He says, when they come together, now we understand the meaning of bir by itself, the meaning of taqwa by itself. Now he says, when they come together, then the difference between them is like, is the same as the difference between something which is sought for لغيره, which means because, which is done for some other purpose, and something which is sought for itself, which means it is like the difference between the means and the goals. So one of them becomes a means and the other becomes a goal. فَإِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَطْلُوبٌ لِذَاتِهِ, because we seek birr for itself, which means, in other words, that is what our actions are supposed to be, righteous. Where did it go? Oh, okay. You want to step on it. So, bir is what should be the goal of our deeds. They should be righteous. And taqwa is the way to attain, the means to attain this, to attain righteousness. Okay, now as you see, this is so far the introduction to the letter, which is just to lay down some principles about the meaning of birr and taqwa. Sorry, I'm facing this side more than the other side. I think it's here, inshallah. It's okay. Then he comes at the end of this introduction to Ithm wal-Udwan, and he says that these are parallel to Bir wa Taqwa. They're parallel on the other side, on the evil side, is the Ithm wal-Udwan. and they are treated similarly, or their understanding, now that we know how to understand Bir and Taqwa, the understanding of these terms is similar. And the difference between Ithm and Adwan, Ithm, sinning, and Adwan, which means to transgress your limits, is like the difference between what is prohibited for its kind or what is prohibited for its amount. Which means it is a different something. Sinning is something that's prohibited because it being bad. Let me give you an example. For example, pork. It is prohibited because it is this material in itself is bad, is evil. But eating too much food so that our stomach hurts and we have to be taken to the hospital after that is prohibited because we transgressed. We ate over our limit. Okay, so that is Adwan. Ithm, so the action was not prohibited in itself, but it is prohibited because a person took more of it than is allowed. فالإثم ما كان حراما لجنسه. So Ithm is that which is prohibited because of its kind. And Adwan ما حرم لزيادة في قدره. And the Adwan, transgression, is that which is prohibited because it went beyond its limit or its amount, and went beyond what Allah has allowed. So zina and khamr and stealing, these are all ithm, sinning, sins. Nikah al-khamis, to marry a fifth wife is Adwan, and to take more than your right from a person is Adwan, and so on. Adwan is to go beyond the limits that Allah has set, as Allah Azza wa Jalla said, "Tilka hududullahi fala ta'taduha, wa man yata'adda hududallahi fa ulaika humudh zalimun." These are the limits of Allah, so do not overstep them, because whoever does that, those are the unjust or transgressors. Then he goes back to what he started with, which is, if you remember, he said that this ayah وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان, help each other in bir and taqwa, do not help each other in ithm and adwan. We said that this part refers to dealing with people, that we should help each other to do righteousness and piety or bir and taqwa, and we should help each other to stop doing, or we should not help each other to do Ithm and Adwan, sinning and transgression. So this is the dealing of people among each other. This is this part of the ayah. Now the next part, as we said earlier, Wattaqullah. This first part is for people's dealing among each other. The second part is for people's dealing between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wattaqullah, and have taqwa of Allah. So this ayah is also reminding or indicating the obligation of a person between him and his creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now here is a sentence which took very long time to translate, so I'm not going to try it again. If you read it to me from there, see how we ended up translating it. It says, this will not be complete unless a person isolates himself from, about isolating himself from the wasat,
evils of the people.
Okay, go ahead, read it aloud. Let me read it inshallah, yeah. on the mic. Where is it? Yeah, one cannot fulfill the first obligation unless he detaches himself from the evils of people, sincerely offering them advice, yeah, being good to them and caring about their well-being. And one cannot fulfill the other obligation unless he eliminates all creatures from between himself and Allah, and does so with sincerity, love and adoration. Now it was very hard to translate, because from the first, when you read it first, you think that this is some of the nonsensical words of the Sufis. Doesn't make sense at all, because he says the first obligation cannot be fulfilled unless one isolates himself from the middle. He used the word middle. And do that for pure nasiha and ihsan, goodness, and fulfilling the affairs. I mean, I'm trying to be somewhat literal, very literal. And the other one is not fulfilled except by isolating the creatures from the connection, and doing that by Allah sincerely and lovingly and with ubudiyyah. So as you see, it doesn't make sense at all if we say it that way. And this is what the way I read it is what he means actually. What he is saying is that one should remove himself from that which comes between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what he's saying. So anything which blocks us from Allah, we should isolate ourselves and detach ourselves from it. And yeah, so that's basically what this sentence is all about. And then he brings a statement from Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, which and as I said earlier, people say that he is a great Sufi, but we believe that he was not. He was one of the people of Sunnah. He said, "Kun ma'a al-haqqi bila khalq wa kun ma'a al-khalqi bila nafs." وَمَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ كَذَلِكَ لَمْ يَزَلْ فِي تَخْبِيطٍ وَلَمْ يَزَلْ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. Says, be with the khalq, with the creatures, with the creation, without khalq. مَعَ الْحَقِّ, sorry. Be with Allah without khalq, which means let your relation with Allah be without the... let it not be marred with the people, with the creatures. Let it be a direct relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let your relation with people be without spirit, which means when you deal with them, it is not because you want to be totally involved and immersed, submerged in their dealings and life, but you deal with them just as the minimum needed with dealing with people. Your goal is not people and their pleasure, but it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His pleasure. And then he says that this is an introduction that is meant... it is not meant for itself, but for what is coming after it. After that, there is a good deal of this risala which discusses hijrah, migration, hijrah to Allah and His Messenger. And here he uses very eloquent language in the Arabic, and we tried hard to transfer it to English as much as possible, without being too literal to the degree that we will the text loses its meaning. And after going through many iterations, maybe it was the same text was translated 5 or 10 times and reviewed and corrected by brothers, we came up with the version that you have in your hands. But he's talking about Ibn Qayyim starts by describing the person who is traveling in this life like an individual, like a stranger, and then he is seeking a way that will benefit him, that will lead him to the in the right direction. And then he finds that, or Allah guides him, guides the believers to that which is the only way to make him reach his goal, and that is that he should migrate to Allah and His Messenger. And then he says something very important, which is that this migration is a fard ayn. It is an obligation on every individual. So not like some people say, think it is a voluntary deed. If you do it, fine. If you don't do it, it's okay. No, it is an obligation on every individual, and he says at all times. At all times of our life, every day, every minute, we have to continue to migrate to Allah and His Messenger. And then he explain that there are two types of hijrah. There is hijrah with our body, migrating with our body from one country or from one land to another land. And he says the rules, the laws, the legislations regarding this type of hijrah are well known to people, because this is documented in the books of fiqh. Who is supposed to migrate? How about the old people? How about the children? How about women? What if a person does not migrate? What is his status in Islam when he is obliged to migrate? Things like that. So he says this is known. We do not need to discuss it here. But what is important is the second type of hijrah, migrating to Allah and His Messenger with the heart. And this is what is intended and meant here. This hijrah, he says, is the true hijrah. And the hijrah with the body follows it. It is a branch of it. It is not the foundation and the basis. It is the result of this first hijrah. And this hijrah, he says, includes two things, two factors. When you say hajara, when you say a person migrated, you have to say migrated from one land to the other. So you have to say from where and to where. So it has min and ila, as he says, and it is from one place to the other. So he migrates with his heart from loving other than Allah to loving Allah alone. This is the hijrah. It means to migrate, to take our hearts from loving other than Allah to loving Him alone. From having ubudiyya, submission and worshipping other than Him to devotion to Him alone. From fearing other than Him to fearing Him alone. From trusting and having reliance on anyone other than Him to trusting Him. From fearing anyone else to fearing Him. From seeking, having hope, our hope in anyone else, to having our hope, putting our hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. From dua, making dua to anyone other than Him, to making dua to Him. From submission and humiliating ourselves before anyone other than Him, to humiliating ourselves before Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he says, this is the meaning of firar to Allah, to run away or to escape to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fafirru ila Allah, run away to Allah. As in the Quran, fafirru ila Allah, in Surah Al-Dhariyat. And the tawheed, which is required from a abd, from a person, is to run away from Allah to Allah. He'll have a very beautiful discussion still further down about this meaning, running away from Allah to Allah, migrating from. We have spoken about migrating from things, from directing worships to other than Allah, any act of worship, to directing it to Allah alone. This is the meaning of migration. And then he says this is the meaning of running away from Allah to Allah, and he'll explain why this is so. He says there is a great secret or a great meaning of Tawheed, not to be literal, a great meaning of Tawheed under this heading, the heading of from and to, going from one place to another. Running away, running to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means that we will direct our seeking, our asking, our ubudiyya, anything that derives from ubudiyya, from servitude and worship, to Him alone. And this is the meaning, this includes, or under this comes the meaning of Tawheed al-Ilahiyya, the Tawheed of Ilahiyya, to have the belief in Allah as being the only God, true God, or the only Ilah. And which is the Tawheed upon which was consensus among the messengers. This is the consensus in the da'wah of all the messengers, that the only thing that they, this is the thing that they all agree to call people to, believing in the ilahiyya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Tawheed al-Ilahiyya is the same meaning as Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, as the same as Tawheed al-Ibadah, the same meaning as Tawheed al-Ubudiyya, as I indicated, I think, in the translation in a footnote there. So this is the meaning of running to Allah. How about running from Him? Running from Him, he says, includes the meaning of Tawheed al-Rububiyya. See how, subhanAllah, the deep understanding of scholars like Ibn Qayyim and Ibn Taymiyyah, especially, and there are many of our great scholars like that, who they take few words that you do not think they can carry such a great amount of meaning, and they explain to you how they obviously carry that amount of meaning. Firru min Allah. Firru ila Allah. When Allah says firru ila Allah, who would think that this means I believe that Allah is the Rabb and Allah is the law, is the Ilah? It's not obvious, but actually it is clear after he explains it that this word means, it includes all the meaning of La ilaha illallah. Fafirru ilallah. So he says running from him to him includes the meaning of Tawheed al-Rububiyya and also believing in Al-Qadr, the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because when we are running from Him, it means we are running from everything that He created, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are running away from disobedience. We are running away from sins. We are running away from things that we are afraid from, our enemies, the disasters of the world. All of these are things created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we are running away from them, we are running from Allah. But where do we run from Allah? We can only run to Him. Running away from Allah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all these, that since we are saying that everything is created by Allah, therefore we are confirming Tawheed al-Rububiyya, that Allah is the Rabb. Allah is the only creator and Lord and owner and director and manager of this universe. So this is Tawheed al-Rububiyya. And then we believe in Al-Qadr, that whatever Allah wants to happen, wills to happen in this creation, will happen. And the only way I can protect myself from the disasters of the world, from Al-Qadr of Allah, is by running unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is believing that everything in the universe, hated or feared and so on, that we try to run away from, it only occurs with the will of Allah alone. So whatever He wills will happen and will occur, will exist by His will subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whatever He does not will not take place. مَا يَشَاءَ كَانْ وَمَا لَمْ يَشَأْ لَمْ يَكُنْ وَامْتَنَعُ وُجُودُهُ لِعَلَمِ مَشِيئَتِهِ, and then it will not exist because Allah did not will it to exist. So when a abd, when a person runs away, runs to Allah, he is running to Him, alhamdulillah, he runs to Him, he is running to Him from something that happened by His will subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is actually running from Allah to Allah. And then he says, therefore whoever can envision, can understand this properly, will understand the meaning of the what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wa a'udhu bika mink, the dua of Aisha radiallahu anha, or the important dua also of Al-Bara bin Azib before going to sleep, la manja wa la manja minka illa ilayk, the dua of Aisha, in which that she said the Prophet ﷺ used to say this frequently in his prayer, in his sujood, in his tashahud at the end. Allahumma inni a'udhu bi ridaka min sakhatik wa bi mu'afatika min uqubatik wa a'udhu bika mink la ahsi thana'an alayka anta kama athnayta ala nafsik. Oh Allah, I seek refuge. I want to run away. Help me to run away from أو من يعوذ برضاك من سخطك. From your سخط to your رضا. From your anger to your pleasure. وبمعافاتك من عقوبتك. And from your punishment to the well-being that you grant. To safety, to your safety. ومعافاتك من عقوبتك. وأعوذ بك منك. And I seek refuge from you, with you. So it is asking Allah to protect me from him. I seek refuge from you, with you. لا أحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. I cannot enumerate or say enough praises to you. It is as you praise yourself. Aisha رضي الله عنها said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to say this, the last thing he would say before at the end of the witr prayer. And he told, I don't know if I mentioned this, that he told the Sahaba that they should learn this dua. Is it mentioned here, Suhail? Okay. And the other dua of Bara ibn Azib, in which he said that the Prophet ﷺ told him before going to sleep to say, to sleep on his right hand side and say this following dua and make it the last thing that he says, which is Allahumma wajjahtu wajhi ilayk, O Allah, I turn my face to you. So after we sleep in our beds, turn to, on the right hand side, say Allahumma wajjahtu wajhi ilayk, O Allah, I turn my face to you. Wa aslamtu nafsi ilayk, and I give up, surrender my soul to you. Because we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها والتي لم تمت في منامها. He takes away the souls at the time of death and those which did not die at the time of sleep. So he takes all our souls. فيمسك التي قضى عليها الموت فيمسك التي قضى عليها الموت ويرسل الأخرى إلى أجل مسمى. So he keeps the one about for which he decreed death, that it is those who died, the souls will stay, they will not come back. وَيُرْسِلْ أُخْرَى, and he will let the others go back until an appointed time, which is the time of death. So we are giving up our souls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I say, O Allah, I turn my face to you, I submit my soul to you. وَأَسْلَمْتُ نَفْسِي إِلَيْكَ وَأَلْجَأْتُ ظَهْرِي إِلَيْكَ. Yeah, there is one more. وَفَوَّضْتُ أَمْرِي إِلَيْكَ, which means I give my affairs or give the reign of my affairs to you, which means I seek your help in my affairs. فَوَّضْتُ أَمْرِي إِلَيْكَ وَأَلْجَأْتُ ظَهْرِي إِلَيْكَ, and I shelter my back to you. As you know, if you are afraid of someone and you have a strong backing behind you, a strong building, you feel very secure. So when we say this, when you say this with understanding, it really gives you a feeling of security, that I am putting my back to you, I am supporting myself on you, I'm taking refuge in you. So when we say this, it gives a great feeling of serenity to the person who is going to bed. اللهم وجهت وجهي إليك وأسلمت نفسي إليك وفوضت أمري إليك وألجأت ظهري إليك رهبة ورغبة إليك. Out of رغبة, hope and رهبة, fear of you. رغبة ورهبة إليك. لا ملجأ ولا منجا منك إلا إليك. There is no ملجأ, there is no refuge, and there is no safety or hiding, ولا منجا منك, from you, except with you. Same thing as the other one, I run from you to you. Here, لا ملجأ ولا منجا منك إلا إليك. To the rest of this dua, آمنت بكتابك الذي أنزل ونبيك الذي أرسلت. So all of these share this same common meaning of hijra, migrating from something to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that something is a created thing by Allah. So he says, now observe how all of this comes back to the same meaning of running from Allah to Allah, and this is what al-hijrah, migration, means. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ said, al-muhajiru man hajara as-sayyi'at, or here he says it, cited al-muhajiru man hajara ma naha Allahu an. Al-muhajir is the one who migrated from that which Allah from that which Allah prohibited. And the other part of the hadith is what is it? It is al-muslimu min sani al-muslimuna min yadi wa lisani wal-muhajiru man hajara as-sayyi'at wal-mujahidu man jahada hawahu lillah. So the Muslim is the one, here the hadith shows the great aspect of eloquence of the Prophet ﷺ, where he uses the words from the same origin, from the same basis, with different meanings in each part of the hadith. Al-Muslimu man salima al-Muslimuna min yadihi wa lisani. Al-Muslim and salima. The Muslim is one whom the Muslims are salim, secure from his hand and his tongue. So he does not hurt other Muslims with his hand or his tongue. That's a true Muslim. Al-Muslimu man salima al-Muslimuna min yadihi wa lisani. Wal-Muhajiru man hajara as-sayyi'at. The Muhajir is the one who made hajr. Muhajir and hajr, the same root word of the word. Al-muhajir man hajara sayyat, the one who migrated from sayyat, from evil deeds. Wal-mujahid man jahada hawahu lillah. And the mujahid is the one who makes jihad or strives with his hawa for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here it tells that Muhajir is the one who migrated from sinning. So this is the basic of hijrah. The hijrah with the body is based on the foundation of hijrah with the heart, of hijrah migrating from that which Allah prohibited. So this means that hijrah is includes the meaning or refers to to departing from that which Allah hates and doing what He is pleased with. And the one who migrates from one thing to another, he must be migrating from something which he does not like, or he must migrate to a place which he loves more, to a place from a place which he loves less. To a place which he loves more, which is migrating to Allah, whom we should love more than anything or anyone else, we migrate to Him from things that we hate or we love less than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيُؤْثِرُ أَحَبَّ الْأَمْرَيْنِ إِلَيْهِ عَلَى الْآخَرِ. So we give preference. No? دخل ظنيت ستة وربع ولا لا؟ So one gives preference to the dearest of the two things to him over the less dear of the two things. So if the nafs of the person, if his desires, his shaitan, are inviting him to anything different from what he Allah loves and accepts, and as he says, he has the balwa, he is tested and tried by these three things, the nafs, the hawa, the desire, and the shaitan, then they will continue to invite him to something which is different or conflicting with Allah's pleasure. So, and they do this all the time, right? So we are always under the influence of these three things: our nafs, our desires, and the shaitan. Therefore, since this is always the case, therefore we always have to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, migrate to Allah from these things that we hate, or we should be hating because Allah hates. We should always be migrating from them to Allah. And this is the meaning that he was saying earlier, that this hijrah should be ongoing all the time, without ceasing, without stopping, at every time, all the time, and it is fard ayn on every person. ولا ينفك في هجرته إلى الممات, and a person should not stop doing this hijrah until death. So it's something that, unfortunately or fortunately, Allah alam, but it is something written on us. We cannot run away from it, from the fact that we have to continue going through this hijrah until we die. We have to continue fighting with our nafs, with our desires, with the shaitan throughout our life until the time of death. And he says, this hijrah becomes stronger or weaker dependent on the amount of love in the heart of the person. Because as we were saying, that a person who migrates, he migrates from a place he migrates to a place that he loves a lot, from a place that he doesn't like as much. That's how we usually do it. We want to go to a place that we love. We know that we'll be pleased, we'll be happy, and we'll be satisfied with our life. We'll be living a relaxed and easy living. That is what we want to go to. And you want to go away from a place which does not satisfy this or provide this for us. A place where our life is tight, unhappy, and insecure, and so on. So we want to migrate from a place that we hate to a place that we like or love. Now imagine that you have two places which are almost similar to you. A place that where you are living in, and another place that seems to be about the same to you. It will offer probably some advantages over the place that you are in, but it also has some disadvantages. So on the overall, in your heart, they are equal. So do you expect yourself wanting to migrate from the place you are in to the other place? You won't, because you say, why should I go there? I have what I want here, or this will not give me any additional benefit or any additional reward. So let me stay where I am. It's like water. Water, if you leave it in a container, it will not, in a deep container, it will not want to go up. But if you put it in a high place, it wants to roll down to a place which it loves more, the lower place. It will like to fall down to the place where it has the most qarar, the most stability down there. Similarly for ourselves, we always seek and tend to the place where we have, which we love the most, where we are satisfied and expect to have the most stability, the most security, the most equilibrium in that place. Now if the two places are the same in our eyes, we will not want to make hijrah. And if the other place is slightly better in our eyes than the place we are in, we want to go there, but not very much. We not have much yearning for it, just a little bit. The more that place is beloved to us, the more that we want to go there. So that's why he says this migration becomes stronger or weaker depending on the amount of love that we have for that place. And what is that place? It's Allah. No, I'm not saying that Allah is a place. I'm saying we want to migrate to Allah. Okay, so don't say that you heard me saying this in my tongue. So we are saying we want to migrate from the sins and desires and the whispers of the shaitan to that whom we love, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the love is weak in our hearts, we do not want to do it. We would not want to do it. So that would be the problem. So as the stronger the amount of love in the heart of the person, the more complete and perfect and strong that the hijrah will be. Otherwise, it will be so weak that it can barely be noticed, and the person will not want to budge to go on this important and obligatory migration. Now he says with some sarcasm at the end of this section, he says, what is amazing is that you find a person gives or discusses in detail, and bringing all the different masail, the different discussions regarding migrating from the land of kufr to the land of Islam, and regarding the hijrah which ended by fatah, by the conquering Mecca, which is a temporal migration, because as you know, the hijrah from Mecca to Medina ended with fatah, as the Prophet ﷺ said, لا هجرة بعد الفتح, which means there is no migration after fatah. There is no need. Why? Because now the two lands are equal. Mecca and Medina are equal. As we said, you migrate from a place, from a hateful place to a good place. And Mecca was hateful at the time when it was under the rule of the kuffar. But when it was liberated, now it is a land of Islam, like Medina. So there's no meaning of migrating, saying I'm migrating from Mecca to Medina. Okay, so that hijrah ended by conquering Mecca. So he says some people spend their time discussing the details, the fiqh issues related to the hijrah which ended with fatah, or the hijrah in general from the lands of Islam, kufr, to the lands of Islam, when this hijrah is temporal and passing, and maybe it will not apply to some people in their whole lifetime. If a person is living in the land of Islam, he will never need to make hijrah. So there is no need for him to discuss or to learn about this hijrah in the first place. But as for that hijrah, this hijrah, he says, which he's discussing, which is an obligation. As much as we breathe, we have to continue making this hijrah. You find that this person who discusses, makes these discussions, he does not try to understand it, to seek the knowledge about it, or to have the will to do it. And that is only because he turns away from that for which he was created, and he gets busy with something which وَالِاشْتِغَالِ بِمَا Yeah, and I don't know how I translated it, because this is also somewhat confusing to translate. It would probably be better to be there. And to get busy with Okay. Thus he turns away from that for which he has been created, and which alone can save him, which means this hijrah alone can save him. So he gets busy from it and involves himself in that which of itself cannot save him. That other hijrah, the hijrah with the body, may not save him. I mean, sometimes it would save some people who are living in the land of kufr and have to go to the land of Islam. But to many people, it is not relevant to them. So they get busy with that which is not relevant instead of that which is most relevant. And he says this is the situation of the one whose eyesight has become weakened, and his knowledge has become weak regarding the levels of knowledge and deeds. That is, which deeds are more important, which parts of knowledge are more important. Okay. The next part here, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah deals with migration to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this basically means that one has to obey the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in every little and big affair of his life as much as he can. He should have full submission to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm sure that you hear lots of discussions related to this issue of importance in the manhaj, but I will just go over what Ibn al-Qayyim mentions regarding the ayah in which Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. In Surah An-Nisa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making a qasam, making a yameen, بِأَجَلِّ مُقْسَمٍ بِهِ, with the greatest with which people make an oath. Because as you know, some people make an oath with their fathers, some with trees, some with stars, some with etc., etc. And we Muslims do not make oath except with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are forbidden to make oath with anyone else. Allah Azza wa Jal, the creator of everything, can make oath with anything that He created to remind us of the greatness of that thing. And He also makes oath with Himself in a few occasions, and this is one of the few. He is making an oath with himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ فَأَقْسَمَ سُبْحَانَهُ بِأَجَلَّ مُقْسَمٍ بِهِ. He made qasam with the greatest or most glorious with which you can make an oath. وَهُوَ نَفْسَهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ, which is Himself, subhanahu عَزَّ وَجَلْ, عَلَى أَنَّهُ لَا يَثْبُتُ لَهُمُ الْإِيمَانِ. And here there's another thing which Ibn Qayyim does not mention, other scholars do, that he says فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ. He did not say فَلَا وَالرَّبِّ or فَلَا وَرَبِّ النَّاسِ, but he said فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ. So he made nisbah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, of himself to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is a very great honoring to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this ayah he's saying your Lord. He did not say the Lord or the Lord of the people, but your Lord. He's talking to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Know by your Lord, to remind us of his honor by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing him like this in this ayah. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَثْبُتَ لَهُمُ الْإِيمَانِ. Iman is not confirmed to them, and they will not be of the people of Iman, of the deserving people of Iman, حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوا, until they accept the judgment of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in all matters of difference. فيما شجر بينهم, and as you say, the word ما means a siga of umum, which means a word of generality, which means everything that takes place or arises among them. So there is a negation of iman from anyone who does not accept the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all affairs that take place among the people. He says, and he did not stop here. Allah Azza wa Jalla did not stop here, but added to it, انشراح صدورهم بحكمه, that their hearts should be pleased with the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. انشراح صدورهم بحكمه, with the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not to Allah, with the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that they would not find in their chests any tightness. ثم حيث لا يجدون في أنفسهم حرجا وهو الضيق والحصر, which is tightness. He explains it. من حكمه, because of what he decided or judged. بل يقبلوا حكمه بالانشراح, rather they would accept it with pleasure. ويقابلوه بالتسليم, and they respond to it with submission. And not that they take it with blindness. Take me. Not that they take it with blindness and drink it as if when you drink some water which has some dirt in it. You know how if you have to drink it, somebody gives you a drink and you notice that there are some impurity and dirt in it. So you drink it and you try to avoid the dirt. But if you are thirsty and somebody gives you a clean drink without qadha in it, without dirt in it, you take it and drink it all of it, all together, without stopping. So that is how we should take the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And anybody who doesn't do that, then this will be conflicting with his iman. So his taking of the judgment should be بقبول ورضا وانشراح الصدر, with acceptance and pleasure. And then he says here another sarcastic complaints from Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah about the situation of Muslims in his time and in our time, of course. He says Okay, before that, let me finish the ayah. He says, وَيُسَلِّمُ تَسْلِيمًا, that Allah Azza wa Jal said, and they should submit with full submission. So the word taslima, يُسَلِّمُ تَسْلِيمًا, he brought the masdar, the abstract noun of يُسَلِّمُ تَسْلِيمًا, to reconfirm and reaffirm the importance of taslim. And this means the total and full submission. And it is the submission of somebody who loves what he is given, and it becomes dear to him and part of his life, unlike somebody who is forced and who is obliged without liking to take what he is given. So he says, Subhanallah, exalted be Allah, كم من حزازة في نفوس كثير من الناس من كثير من النصوص وبودهم أن لم ترد وبودهم أن لو لم ترد. Say Subhanallah, how many times you find there is displeasure in the hearts of some people or many people from some texts, which means texts from the Quran and Sunnah, and they wish that they were never revealed or never sent down. وَكَمْ مِنْ حَرَارَةٍ فِي أَكْبَادِهِمْ مِنْهَا, and how much heat in their livers, he says, from it. I don't know, this is literal, I don't know how I translated it there. What did I say there?
Hatred in their hearts.
A hatred in their hearts. Okay. وَكَمْ مِنْ شَجَنْ فِي حُلُوقِهِمْ, he used in the Arabic the meaning, how much heat in their liver, which means same thing, I mean hatred in their heart and the inside of their hidden thoughts. وَكَمْ مِنْ شَجَنْ فِي حُلُوقِهِمْ مِنْهَا وَمِنْ مَوْرِدِهَا, and how much shaja means like when you have a thorn or something that is in a lump in your throat because of what was said or what happened. So how much lumps it caused in their throats because of it or because of sending these texts or these ayat. And what they hide in their sara'ir, in their secrets, will be exposed to the other people on the day when Allah Azza wa Jal will expose the secrets. And this is indeed true, that you find some people, some of them Muslims, some of them considered scholars of Islam, who say, as Al-Kawthari is reported, who was Zahid Al-Kawthari, was a scholar of hadith of his time early in this century, and there are some ahadith in Sahih Muslim, and Sahih Bukhari, he says, I wish that this hadith was never there, and I wish I can prove that it is daif and unauthentic. Why? Because it conflicts with some of his ideas and some of his beliefs, madhhabi beliefs and ash'ari beliefs in aqidah. There is following that a long linguistic discussion about why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ, why did he say فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ and he did not say فَوَرَبِّكَ, why he started by negation فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ, no by your Lord, but no by your Lord, and he did not say but by your Lord, he said but no by your Lord, why did he say that? And he tells us that this is common in the language of the Arabs and in the language of the Quran, as you find he brought several examples to show that when you have a negation in the center, in the sentence that will be coming on, and you start with a negation, this is more eloquent and emphatic than if you start without the negation. So what is the negation in the sentence? There is a negation of iman. Allah is negating the iman. لا يؤمنون. So if we start by saying لا وربك لا يؤمنون, it's stronger than to say فوربك لا يؤمنون. To say by your Lord they will not believe is weaker than to say no by your Lord they will not believe, because of the negation there, by your Lord they will not believe. So because of that negation, if you started with another negation, it makes it stronger in affirming the intended meaning. He discusses after that in a long discussion the situation. See how much time we have left. We have a few minutes left. So obviously, as I was anticipating, we'll not be covering the whole thing. So after that, he discusses the situation of those who disagree with the Prophet ﷺ and reject his sunnah or do not want to submit themselves to it. This, of course, gives you a glimpse into this book, because there is much more to it. He will talk after that about the happy ones and the miserable ones, and how a person will be happy and how a person will be miserable. After that, he brings some of the some examples of the tafsir of the Quran, how we can understand the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through an example that he gave from the visit of the angels to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And he brings that ayah, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ ضَيْفِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ, and he tells, he first asks, what would a common person expect or think that the meaning of this ayah or these ayat are, is, and then he shows that indeed there is much more meaning there than what we can ever expect. And then he says that this is how you need to understand all of the Quran. For example, why did Ibrahim bring a big ajal, calf? Why did he bring a fat calf? Why was it not thin? Why was it a ajal, a calf, and why it was not a cow? And he shows you that there is so much praise to Ibrahim for the amount of generosity that he had in a few ayat that to many people it is not apparent or obvious. For example, فَقَرَّبَهُ إِلَيْهِمْ قَالَ أَلَا تَأْكُلُونَ, he brought it close to them. So he brought the food even without asking them. He went and brought the food, prepared it, put it in front of them. So it is not that he prepared it in another room and he said, okay, please come and serve yourselves. No, he put it in front of them. That is of the son of generosity of Ibrahim, and that is what was inherited from him by what is known as the Arabian generosity, because the Arabs at those times, in the early times of Islam, were known to be very generous, and maybe some of them you can still find that among the people who live in the rural or desert areas, that they are very generous with the guests. So he brought the food and put it in front of them instead of putting it and inviting them to it. This is another indication of generosity. And then he said, أَلَا تَأْكُلُونَ, wouldn't you eat? He was like, you know, pleading them, wouldn't you eat? He didn't say, go ahead and eat. He said, wouldn't you eat? So and there are many other examples which show you how Ibrahim was indeed very generous, much more than what we can think. And in a few ayat that many people will not realize them when they in a few words that some people will not notice them when they read this. And then he tells us some other meanings that are in these few ayat, including the hallowing or emphasizing the greatness and uniqueness of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very quick indication, besides many other meanings in these ayat. So there's no time for that. And in the very end, of course, Ibn al-Qayyim concludes by saying that this is I have to read it from the translation now, because after a long study of the last part, it was obvious that there was a mistake in the order. In all printings that are available in the Arabic language, there's a mistake in the order of the text. So you have to take some parts back and forth and fix the sentences so that the flow of the meaning was correct. So he concludes by saying, If you peer into the words contained, which if you look in the Arabic text, it's much further up in the text. If you peer into the words contained in these leaflets, you will perceive that they describe what is most required for mutual help in birr and taqwa, which is, as you see, what he started the book with, or the letter with, and in migrating to Allah and His Messenger. This is what the author intended when he wrote this treatise. He's talking about himself. I don't know what he used for the author there, but he's talking about himself, so it's not like somebody else is talking about him. Making it an early and expedited gift to his friends and companions in seeking the knowledge. So this is an advice to those who want to seek the knowledge, how to seek it. Seek it by having birr and taqwa, by migrating continuously to Allah and His Messenger, by being among the happy people and not the miserable ones, by understanding the Quran properly. By that all, inshallah, they'll be among the people who truly seek the knowledge. Allah is the witness, and Allah is sufficient as a witness, that in this if this treatise reaches any of such friends, he will meet it with acceptance and will hasten to understand it and will consider it as one of the best possible gifts among friends. Other types of material bountiful gifts, even if people look forward to them, have little benefits and are extremely trivial because too many people can give them. Indeed, a useful gift is a good word that a man presents to his Muslim brother. Allah Ta'ala indeed knows best. In conclusion, may Allah bestow His mercy. Yeah, I'm making sure that this is from the original text. May Allah bestow His praise and blessings and perfect peace on our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his family and companions until the Day of Judgment. And Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Okay. And we are right on time, 1.5 hours. So in the remaining time for Maghrib, until Maghrib, we can either ask questions or I ask questions. Okay, you know, once we start letting the allowing questions, I think they will never end, but go ahead, inshallah.
Who asked the question to the imam and what was the question?
I don't know now. Maybe I knew when I was writing in the beginning, but now I don't know. If it was obvious, I may have included it in the introduction. Is there any reference to it in the introduction? Then it is not, we cannot tell except by the thing at the end, that it is some people who asked him